I want to start this morning with a quotation from Robert Sloot, who is a professor of drama and Jewish studies. "The usually quiet unfolding of human history is sometimes interrupted by events of shattering and lasting effect on the lives of whole peoples. In the 20th century, the world has seen more than a few of such events. A case could be made, for example, that the exploration of the solar system in the 1960s and 70s in a benign way qualifies as such an event because it forced people to revise the understanding they have of themselves and their relationship to the world around them. During their course and in their aftermath, such events, by causing nations and people to rethink the central questions of existence, have been the inspiration for the imaginative literature of every age, as history is retold and re-experienced in song and story, poem and play. Among the events of recent Western history that today reside in our consciousness, none is more disturbing than the Holocaust. More than any other event in our time, the Holocaust has caused entire nations and peoples to revise understandings of themselves by provoking disquieting and continuing ignorance of the most moral kind. It forced individuals to reassess their knowledge of the human species, a reassessment which has deepened and intensified by the large body of testimony of witnesses of those who were personally touched by the Holocaust produced. The texts that you'll hear this morning come from several primary sources. First, poetry by the Jewish-German writer Paul Celan, who you've heard from already, who was deported to a ghetto at the start of World War II, was later taken to a labor camp in Romania, and finally worked as a nurse in a mental hospital until the end of the war. Second, poetry by Charlotte Delbo, who was imprisoned in Auschwitz for her involvement in the French resistance. She survived in the camp until its liberation. You may recognize one of the excerpts as being from The Diary, one of the Nazi Holocaust's most famous young writers, Annelise, Marie, and Frank. The bulk of the stories and poems you'll hear this morning come from a compilation of poetry, prose, drawings, and collages created by the children who lived in the Czech town of Terezín. When German troops crossed the Czech frontier, Terezín was converted into Terezínstadt, a Jewish ghetto. Over 141,000 Jews passed through Terezínstadt. 33,456 died in the ghetto. 88,202 were transported to death camps. Of the 15,000 children deported from Terezínstadt to Auschwitz, 100 survived. No one under the age of 14. All of the words you'll hear this morning come from two adults who survived the Holocaust and many young people who did not. Whether the author is a victim or a survivor, you'll hear common threads in their stories and poems. Often Holocaust literature contains gruesome details, stories of fear, photographs of piles of corpses. But what's more apparent in these texts is the anxiety of waiting, of not knowing if the other shoe will ever drop, of hunger, boredom, rumors, frustration with having to keep lights out at night and not being able to read in bed, homesickness, so much homesickness, and most remarkably, hope. These texts humanize those who met the Holocaust. They remove the tattoo from their forearms, fill their bellies with food, and remind us that they're people. They're not what Hitler made them. They're not what Auschwitz made them. They're not statistics. They're our brothers, our sisters, our mothers, our children. And this is why we pray and light candles and gather together in spring to remember, to celebrate their words, and the incredible, intangible thing that happens when, in the face of overwhelming cruelty, we find solace in art and language. There's a woman named Frida Dicker Brandeis, who was a Bauhaus-trained art teacher. And when she found out she was going to be deported to Terezínstadt, she packed extra art supplies instead of extra food and clothing, and with the intention of making art for the children there. And that's exactly what she did. What's more human than that?
Thank you. from the play Who Will Carry the Word by Charlotte Delgo. Because I have returned from where there was no return, you think I know everything, and you've crowded me, bursting with your questions. Questions you cannot even formulate. You think that I know all the answers. All I know are facts. Life, death, truth. I return for truth, for everything there was true. Everything was stamped with truth, a mortal truth clear and sharp without nuance or measure. Pure cruelty, pure horror. Who could bear to face the truth in that cruelty? Close eyes forever, or look on, wide-eyed. Wild-eyed. The only choice, the only chance. The light seared the eyes that darted to see. So why should I speak? For the things I would say could not be of any use to you. The closed town. Everything leans, like a tottering, hunched old woman. Every eye shines with a fixed waiting for the word. Here there are few soldiers. Only the shot down birds tell of war. You believe every bit of news you hear. The buildings now are fuller, body smelling close to body, and the garrets scream with light for long, long hours. We got used to standing in line at 7 o'clock in the morning, at 12 noon, and again at 7 o'clock in the evening. We sit in a long queue with a plate in our hand, into which they ladled a little warm up water with a salty or coffee flavor, or else they gave us a few potatoes. We got used to sleeping without a bed, to saluting every uniform, not to walk on the sidewalks, and then again to walk on the sidewalks. We got used to the undeserved slaps, blows, and executions. We got used to it that from time to time, 1,000 unhappy souls would come here, and that from time to time, another 1,000 unhappy souls would go away. Prose of a 15-year-old, Peter Fischel, who perished in Auschwitz in 1944. Tara, the heaviest wheel rolls across our foreheads to bury itself deep somewhere inside our memory. Suffered here more than enough, here in this cloth of grief and shame, wanting a badge of blindness to be approved for their own children. A fourth year of waiting, like standing above a swamp, from which any moment might gush forth a spring.
Meanwhile, the rivers flow another way, another way, not letting you die, not letting you live. The cannons don't scream, and the guns don't bark.
Our windows must be darkened, and it is forbidden to have any sort of light. Tomorrow, I'm going to the Hamburg barracks for bread, and perhaps I'll manage to see Mom.
bent over to the crimson blood of ages spilled. 15 bodies that waddled up here. 30 eyes seeking quietness. Bald heads that gave out from the prison. The holiness of suffering, which is none of my business. The loveliness of air, which day after day smells of strangeness and carbolic. The nurses that carry thermometers. Mothers who grope after smile. Food is such a luxury here. A long, long night and a weak day. But anyway, I don't want to leave. The lighted rooms and the burning cheeks. Nurses who leave behind them only a shadow to help the little sufferers. I'd like to stay here, a small patient, waiting the doctor's daily round, until, after a long, long time, I be well again. Then I'd like to leave and go back home again.
By Hans Haschenberg.
once will wake and once will see their own blood spilled. I once was a little child, 3 years ago, that child who longed for all the worlds. But now, I am no more a child, for I have learned to hate. I am a grown-up person now. I have no fear. But anyway, I still believe I only sleep today, that I'll wake up a child again and start to laugh and play. I'll go back to childhood sweet like a briar rose, like a bell that wakes us from a dream. Like a mother with an ailing child, loves him with aching woman's love. How tragic then is youth that lives, with enemies, with gallows ropes. How tragic then for children on the lap, to say this for the good and that for the bad.
Thank you.